Hi, I'm Ed Williamson. I'm the chairman of the Williamson Automotive Group. I start mid-morning. First of all, I think it's important to understand that I view my job as being in charge of the atmosphere. I'm in charge of the climate here. I'm not the sales manager or the parts manager or any of those jobs. We've had professional, very good professional general managers for years. So that's his job, is to oversee the nuts and bolts. And my job is to help coordinate everybody to work together. And the parts department and the service department are very closely interrelated, as is the parts department and the body shop, and they both work on cars for the new car department and the used car department, and so getting all of the people to work together all the time is, that's really what I do, but it's even better when they do it, and they can do it if the climate is right. And if they're the right people. Actually, I'm third generation. My mother's dad was a farmer in northeastern Indiana. And in 29, farmers were doing okay during the recession because people had to eat. And so in 29, he had the opportunity. He bought the local Hudson Packard International Harvester dealership. And my parents met at Indiana University and married in 42. And when dad came back from the war, he got involved with the International Harvester store in 45. In 48, they got a Cadillac franchise. In 54, Dad sold his interest back to his father-in-law, and he bought a Cadillac Oldsmobile dealership 200 miles north of here in Lake Wales, which is where I grew up. I ended up, I wanted a Naval ROTC scholarship, and they sent me to Auburn, and I ended up in aerospace and really in structures and computers, and I was working for a company in Columbus, Georgia that made steel buildings, writing computer programs, and so I started working as a junior for them. And after I graduated about three or four months, my dad had sold the dealership in Lake Wales, and he was under construction on a new Cadillac dealership in Miami that was just across from Dadeland Shopping Center. And he said, if you want to ride this train, you got 11 days to get to the station. Because he wanted me in Flint, Michigan at General Motors Institute in what was euphemistically referred to back then as Dealer's Sons School. It's now Sons and Daughters. But so I did that. I was back about the 1st of December. We opened the doors about 2 weeks later. My brother also went to Auburn. He joined us in 70. And in 76, we bought Dad out. It was his idea. He said it wasn't any fun anymore. And he was 55. So he got what he wanted, and we got what we wanted. I think the Beacon Council has come a long way since you mentioned them. I think they've had very good leadership. It's a shame we just lost one of the founders, Sid Levin. I think the whole, what I think they called an HQ2 exercise for Amazon that Southeast Florida was part of, was a very good exercise. And furthermore, this whole thing with the new mega mall that's going in Northwest Dade County, the attraction of that particular enterprise was I think very good for us here also. I think the leadership at the county level is pretty closely aligned with that kind of big development ideas. So I'm much more hopeful than I was 30 years ago. I think one, and it actually started more than 5 years ago, is the rolling up of the retail automobile business by a few public companies. The biggest, of course, is AutoNation. Roger Penske's got two separate operations that does that. There's Sonic and Group One. And then also, Warren Buffett he bought a pretty big chain from the Van Tile Group. They're operating out of an office in Dallas now. They've got some really good stores. So that has changed the whole dealership acquisition scenario. That's one. There are some disruptions that have started in the last 5 years, and one is alternative propulsion, either plug-in cars or hybrids. There's not been much discussion about this, but I think General Motors is going to also renew a push toward fuel cell vehicles. It's going to be a while before it really takes off. Electric propulsion vehicles are still only about 1% of sales. I think three things have to happen before that really takes off. The range has to be the same as a gas car or better. The price has to be the same as a gas car or less. And we've got to get the charging cycle down to about 10 minutes. When that happens, it's not going to 100% take over the industry, but I think that is 8-9 years away. The third thing is, which is just starting to happen, is the automated autonomous vehicles. The one that gets a lot of press, of course, is Tesla's Autopilot, which it's not. But it's close. GM has a version. It's so far it's only available in one model of a Cadillac. It's called Super Cruise. It works pretty good for what it does, but it's still only level one or one and a half. It'll take, I think, until almost 2030 until we have fully operational level five self-driving cars, where you will push a button on an app on your cell phone and walk out your front door and get in a vehicle that has no driver, and it'll take you where you want to go and then disappear while you go to the store or whatever. But I think that we won't see 100% of our transportation needs satisfied by that. People will want to drive, and they're still going to want to keep their golf clubs in the back and their yoga mat, so you got to have personal transportation to do that. But you may be able to have one of those type of vehicles that you own yourself, and you walk over to it and get in and say, take me to my country club. So, I mean, that's the three things that are the big changes.